Hello everyone, and welcome to the 10th webinar of Technology Transfer webinar series. Today's topic will be focused on Infinity Computer, its methodology, patents, prototypes, and applications. And before starting today's presentation with our guest expert, I would first like to give the floor to Luca Escovier, a project manager of the U-Japan Technology Transfer Help Desk. Over to you, Luca.
Thank you, Eva, and good morning, everyone, or good afternoon if you're in here in Japan. As Eva said, this is the 10th webinar of the Technology Transfer Help Desk. As usual, I would like to spend literally a minute on the slide in front of you and then introduce our guest speaker. So as you can see from the slide, here basically you have my contact information with my email. If you're interested in getting in touch with us, you can do it directly by sending us an email to me, or you can check the website, the link that is just underneath. We're still working on a survey on SMEs, so your input or the input of friends or colleagues of yours can be very helpful. So please do share the link with friends and colleagues if they're working in SMEs. And then finally, of course, we're always increasing and hopefully get a larger number of registrants and people interested in hearing from us every now and then. We have a newsletter, so please do register to the newsletter as well, which is, of course, free of charge. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our speaker for today, Professor Yaroslav Sergeyev. Welcome, Professor. Good morning.
Very nice to hear you. Good morning.
Thank you. Let me just spend another minute to introduce you and very, very quickly, even though your bio is extremely long and successful, but just let me say to the audience for today and for the future, when we will also post the video online, that Professor Sergeyev research interests include numerical analysis, global optimization. Since 2016, he's the vice president of the International Society of Global Optimization. And among the research interests, infinity computing, calculus, and fractals. Professor Sergeyev was awarded several international research prizes, especially in the last years, like the Pythagoras International Prize in Mathematics, the Europe Fellow, the Outstanding Achievement Award in 2015 from the World Congress in Computer Science and Computer Engineering, etc., etc. His list of publications contains more than 200 items and 5 books, and he's a member of several editorial boards, namely 6 international journals. He has delivered more than 50 plenary and keynote lectures in prestigious international congresses in universities and other research institutes across the planet. So without further ado, now, Professor Sergeyev, the floor is yours, and please do tell us everything about the Infinity Computer.
Okay, Luca, thank you for this nice introduction. Let us start. So the topic of this webinar is Infinity Computer, methodology, patents, prototypes, and applications. As this is the outline, so we will speak a little bit about Infinity Computer as a radical innovation, and then we'll go into business and I explain how does it work. So as Luca has already mentioned, I have a background in numerical computations and global optimization. And in the last years, I have obtained a number of distinctions and prizes and plenary elections. So all of them are related to global optimization. And then I will show you other prizes that I have been awarded for Infinity Computer. But this is a little bit later. So let us start and speak about computational paradigms. Why new computational paradigms are the future of computations? Because nowadays physical limits, speed and the miniaturization of traditional computers have been almost reached. In very few years, it will not be clear to consumers why they should buy a new computer, because they all will be more or less the same. And the current attention of the scientific and industrial communities is dedicated to new computational paradigms. All kinds of distributed computing, quantum computing, biocomputing, and areas of their possible applications. Because only in these new directions, new paradigms, we will have the possibility to obtain new computational power. However, up to now, they do not exist on the market and conventional alternatives ready for a broad implementation. For instance, a powerful general-purpose quantum computer has not been constructed yet. The D-Wave famous computer is not general purpose. It is able to solve very few concrete problems. So all these kind of new computational paradigms at the moment remain just an idea. Why the infinity computer is a radical innovation? We can mention that there are certain very strong limitation of traditional computers. They work, all of them, with finite numbers only. Numerical computations with different infinities and infinitesimals were impossible so far. The infinity computer is a radical innovation since it is able to execute numerical and not symbolic calculations with finite, infinite, and infinitesimal numbers in a unique framework, opening so a new era in the whole world of computing. With infinity computer, people will not think about if a number is finite, infinite, or infinitesimal. They all will be elaborated in the same way. As now, we do not think if a concrete number is equal to 10 or 12 or 1,000. They all are elaborated in the same way. And the same will be with infinities and infinitesimals. The infinity computer drastically increases the accuracy of computations by substituting qualitative descriptions of the type a number tends to zero or a number tends to infinity by a variety of precise infinitesimal and infinite numbers. It avoids indeterminate forms like infinity minus infinity or infinity divided infinity. It eliminates all kinds of divergences, since it becomes possible to work directly with actual infinite and infinitesimal numbers. It is necessary to say that this invention is an invention that has patents issued in United States of America, Europe, and Russia. And these patents are rather strong because they are written without any specification of the type of hardware implementing the infinity computer. So we have patented the way of doing computations. European trademarks. Gross one, that is, as we will see in a few minutes, a new infinite unit of measure. There exists a working soft prototype of the infinity computer, and I will show you later on a simple toy prototype, the infinity calculator, using this technology. And then there exist websites from where you can download a lot of material. Now, value proposition. We are speaking about the market that includes the entire market of digital processors, including microprocessors, devices for digital elaboration of signals, scientific calculators, so everything. Our idea is that as the arithmetic processor is in all traditional computers, the infinity computer processor should be in all processors in the future. So this is really a huge market. And this is radical innovation, as I have already mentioned. The infinity computer offers to consumers a completely new way of computations, given the possibility to substitute old weak concepts and computational tools by the new ones, offering both an unprecedented enlargement of computable objects, including infinite and infinitesimal numbers, and completely new horizons with respect to the accuracy of computations. We will see this on examples later. And this is a strategic advantage. In the modern world, the power of computation can cause victory or defeat of a firm or even a country. The infinity computer with its supercomputing capabilities gives a strategic advantage for its owners. Now, sorry, I should say that you have seen prizes before for the tech I got for global optimization, and here you can see other prizes that have been given to me for the development of the infinity computer. So we face a real breakthrough appreciated in the scientific community, by the scientific community. MIT Technology Review has dedicated an article to one of the very simple applications of the Infinity computer. Now, what is the difference? So first of all, let us remind that traditional computers work with the finite numbers only. Arithmetic is developed for infinite numbers are quite different with respect to finite arithmetic we are used to deal with, because there are indeterminate form. Infinite numbers often are represented as infinite sequences of finite numbers, and there are technical problems. For example, how to store an infinite number in a finite memory of a computer? It's not clear. This crucial difficulty did not allow people to construct computers that would be able to work with infinite and infinitesimal numbers numerically, and in the same manner as we are used to do with finite numbers. And our goal was to construct such a computer, and we have succeeded in this. Okay, now we should make a distinction between numbers and numerals. So a numeral is a symbol or a group of symbols that represent a number. So number is a concept, and a numeral expresses it. For example, these symbols are different numerals, but they represent the same number. And if we add the rules to write down numerals together with algorithm for executing arithmetic operations, we form a numeral system. You can see that I start to go to the technicalities explaining how, what is the idea behind the Infinity computer. It is necessary to say that different numeral systems can express different sets of numbers, and they can be more or less suitable for executing arithmetical operations. For example, the positional numeral system we use every day is not able to express irrational numbers. For example, the number pi is expressed by the special symbol, this one. And otherwise, with a finite number of symbols, we are not able to express it. Then there exist many numeral systems that are weaker than the positional one. For instance, it is necessary to remind that Roman numeral system is not able to express zero and negative numbers as well. And such an expression, for example, as 3 minus 5 for Romans was an indeterminate form. They were not able to compute it in the same way as we are not able to compute traditional infinity minus infinity. There exist even weaker numeral system. Nowadays in Amazonia there is a tribe, Piraha, and they use only numerals 1 and 2 and are able to see only numbers 1 and 2. They do not suspect about existence of larger natural numbers. All quantities larger than 2 for them are just many, and such operations as 1 plus 2 and 2 plus 2 give the same result, many. No, this happens, of course, not because 1 plus 2 is equal to 2 plus 2, but because the primitive numeral system is weak and they are not able to see the difference between the results of these operations. I'm speaking about because they have another interesting property of the numeral system. The many plus 1 is equal to many, and many plus 2 is equal to many. So this is a striking similarity with our views on infinity. You can see that we have the same way of writing. Infinity plus 1 is equal to infinity, infinity plus 2 is equal to infinity. So just change many with infinity, vice versa, and you see that we behave ourselves in front of infinity in the same way as Piraha behave themselves in front of numbers 3, 4, 5, and so on. And this means that our difficulty in working with infinity is not connected to the nature of infinity, but is a result of inadequate numeral system used to express infinite numbers. So it is necessary to change the numeral system that we use to write down infinity and to enrich it. And how it is possible to do this? Because all of us, we have in our mind this idea infinity plus 1 is equal to infinity. I will show you now a way of counting that will suggest how to proceed. Imagine that we are in a granary and the owner asks us to count how much grain he has inside. Of course, nobody can count the grain seed by seed, and the problem how to count such an enormous number of objects arises. In order to overcome this difficulty, people take sacks, fill them in with seeds, and count the number of sacks. It is important that nobody counts the number of seeds in a sack. We suppose that sacks are very huge. Obviously, all seeds have the same measure, and all sacks can contain the same number of seeds. But this number is so huge that we are not able to calculate it. Then if the granary is large and it becomes difficult to count the sacks, then trucks or even big train wagons are used. At the end of the counting, we obtain a result in the following form. The granary contains 17 train wagons, 12 trucks, 15 sacks, and 54 seeds of grain. So look, the obtained result is with the precision one seed of grain. If we add one seed, we see that we have more. And for we can measure what does it mean more. If we subtract one track, we have less, and again, we can have measure. Obviously, the answer that the granary has many seeds is correct, but its precision is low. Here, we have much higher precision with the accuracy one seed. So, in this example, it was necessary to count large quantities. Quantities are finite, but it was impossible to count them using elementary unit of measure, seeds, because the quantities were too large. So people were forced to behave as if quantities were infinite. And to solve the problem on these quantities, they have introduced new units of measure, sacks, trucks, train wagons, and so on. Thus, it was impossible to formulate the answer in the terms of elementary units, but it is perfectly expressible in the newly introduced unit of measure. Now, it is not known how many units UI there are in the next unit. We do not count how many there are, we just complete the sack. So each new unit contains certain the same number KI of the previous units, but these KI are unknown. In spite of this, we are able to compute with the accuracy of one seed. So it's clear how to proceed. It is necessary to move this idea of counting by separate units of measure from finite but huge numbers to infinite numbers. And this is done by introducing numeral, this one, one so-called, called gross one, and it is introduced as the number of elements of the set of natural numbers. Natural numbers are numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And it is introduced through the infinite unit axioms that is added to axioms for real numbers, as when we move from natural numbers to integers, we say there exists a new object called zero, and there are these operations with this zero. So think a little bit about the future. So Piraha live in some sense in the past, and they use this simple numeral system, one too many. Today, we use this Lemniscate scatter symbol to express infinity, and we are in the space around the Earth. Tomorrow, using new numeral systems, and we will be in the space, in the stars, because more we are able to compute, better will be the progress, and faster will be the progress. Now, the gross one-based numerals allow us to work a lot and to measure different infinite sets. For example, the set of natural numbers traditionally is countable, but we can see that it has gross one elements. If we subtract from the set of natural numbers five numbers, tradition is not able to see this, to register this as the result of this operation, and we are able to see. The set of even numbers or the set of odd numbers, they are countable traditionally, but we can say that they have gross one divided two operations. The set of integers, two gross one plus one operations, and so on. So our analysis of mathematical objects becomes significantly more precise. So I remind you that from one to gross one, we have natural numbers, and then gross one plus one, gross one square, gross one power gross one, and so on, are extended natural numbers. Why this is very important to have more infinite numbers? Because we can now create new objects and to work with all of them. For example, this is a quadratic function, is x squared, and this is its derivative. Now we are able to evaluate them in concrete infinite numbers. For example, this one in x equal to gross 1, or infinitesimal numbers. Gross 1 minus 1 is an infinitesimal, and we are able to do this. Before, we were not able to work with infinite or infinitesimal derivatives of functions. It was prohibited. We can also construct new objects, new functions. For example, this derivative, you can see it is a linear function having an infinitesimal coefficient here and infinite coefficient here. More we have objects to model, more precise models can be done. We completely avoid divergences, both in series and in integrals. For example, here this integral, traditional one, going from zero to infinity, can it diverges, and we cannot say anything about this. Now we can fix concrete points on infinity and to work with them, and we can measure integral from one point infinity to another one and to compute the result easily. And even if the difference in infinity, as here in this integral, from this point to this point is infinitesimal, nevertheless, we are able to compute. Now, what about the computer? In order to have the computer, we should represent in the computer memory infinite and infinitesimal numbers, a variety of all of them. And we use this by applying the positional numeral system with infinite radix gross 1. So this is our numeral, and this is the sum of different powers of gross 1, where C are so-called gross digits. They represent traditional finite numerals, finite numbers, and P are gross powers, and they are all ordered, and they can themselves be numbers of this kind. So if we consider very simple case when we have no positive gross powers and negative gross powers, then we can see that all this record is reduced to just this one, and where C is the finite number. So in this record, finite, our usual finite numbers are just a very particular case. If we have here positive, finite or infinite powers, then in our number there will be infinite parts. If we have here positive, infinite or finite numbers, then in our number there will be infinitesimal parts. So we have all these kind of variety of numbers, and we are able to work with all of them. We are able to work with all of them. For example, the simplest infinitesimal is this number, 1 divided gross 1. This is the inverse element with respect to multiplication, and multiplied by gross 1, it gives 1. All infinitesimals are not equal to 0. For example, this number is positive because it is the result of the division of two positive numbers. So now I'm ready to show how the infinity calculator works, and I ask Eva to share my screen. Okay. Okay, so are you able to see the calculator? Luca?
Yeah, I can see pretty clear.
Okay.
So I guess...
Perfect. So now let us start with executing operations. The first example will be very simple. We will take an infinite number. Okay. We add another infinite number. So you can see these two numbers are infinite because their gross powers are positive. And we sum up, compute, here this is the result. As in traditional positional systems, on the left there are parts having higher gross powers and here lower gross powers. If we subtract, then this second operand will go with the sign minus. Let us now multiply. When we multiply, you can see that this is very easy. The result is an infinite number. We have summed up the gross powers and multiplied gross digits. Now, if we divide, then we subtract gross powers and divide gross digits. Now, let us make things more interesting. Let us add a finite part in our right operand. So if it is finite, then this means that the gross power should be equal to zero. And then let us add an infinitesimal part, so it should have a negative gross power. Okay, so now let us sum up. We obtain the result consisting of two infinite parts, because here we have two positive gross powers, one finite part and one infinitesimal. If we subtract, the second operand goes with the negative sign. If we multiply, all gross powers are summed up and all gross digits are multiplied. And if we divide, then you can see that we subtract gross powers and divide gross digits. You can see that the resulting number is an infinite number having one infinite part and two infinitesimal parts. And there are no finite parts. So you can see that we are able to execute our computations, and we are able to, so we have a computer because we are able to execute these four arithmetical computations. Now, Eva, please let me return to the presentation. Okay, thank you very much. So now I will show you why this is very important. I will show you some numerical examples. The first example is numerical differentiation. Traditionally, suppose that you have a function j of x, and it is represented by a computer procedure f of x, and you need to evaluate the derivative. Unfortunately, if you know the program, the software for evaluating derivatives, you should use these approximations, traditional approximations, where h should be small. In the mathematics, in the abstract mathematics, when h goes to zero, all three formulas give you the derivatives, exact derivatives. Unfortunately, in the world, this is not possible when we compute. Because when we compute, what happens is that the number of digits in the mantissa is limited. So after some small h, here there are equal numbers, and we are not able to proceed. Suppose that we would like to work, I give you a concrete example, with this function. So what happens? By applying that formula, you can see that when h, remind that h is this here, should be a small number, we start to diminish h, and the accuracy of the approximation first goes down, but then it goes up very strongly because we have a limited number in the mantissa and we completely lose accuracy. So it is not possible on the traditional computer by using this formula to obtain the exact values of the derivative. Suppose now that we have this program, this function, programmed on the infinity computer, and we would like in the point y equal to 3, calculate the value of the function, the first derivative, the second and the third one. Then the infinity computer, instead of using that dangerous formula that can remain us without good result, we propose just to evaluate the function in the point 3 plus gross 1 and minus 1. So this is an infinitesimal. The infinity computer will execute this procedure. But we suppose, that we do not know the formula. For us, this is the black box. We do not know what is happening in the infinity computer inside. What we can do, we just read the result of the computation. The result of the computation has one finite part and some infinitesimal part. Now, a piece of magic. Look, the coefficient in the result of the gross 1 power 0 is the exact value of the function. Then, the second coefficient is the exact value of the first derivative. The third coefficient gives us the exact value of the second derivative. This coefficient gives us the exact of third derivative, and so on. So, without application of this formula, just in one shot, we obtain not approximate, but exact values of the function and its derivative. And introduction of these infinitesimal perturbations in the system is very important, and it has a lot of applications. For example, suppose that you have a traditional method, and for some value, a huge code does not work, value I zero. Then what people do? They introduce perturbations, 0.1, 0.01, then this one, and then negative perturbation. And after many, many runs, they try to approximate this result that they are not able to compute by this result. So many runs and approximate result. In the infinity computer, we include this infinitesimal perturbation, and we execute just one run, and we obtain the exact result, because the infinitesimal perturbation part will be separated from the result we are interested in. This is an example with linear system. This is a linear system, and this is its solution. Here you can see that there is zero. And since there is zero, it is not possible to apply the method of Gauss directly. It is necessary to execute the so-called pivoting operations and substitute the first line with the second one. On the infinity computer, we substitute this zero by this perturbation, gross 1 minus 1, infinitesimal 1. And we are able to apply the method of Gauss directly. And when we obtain the result, you can see that the result is here and here, these two numbers, they have finite parts and infinitesimal ones that are separable from finite. And finite parts, again, give us the exact solution. Another example proposed by Renato Galeone, who was the president of International Society of Italy, the Society of Operations Research. So this is a quadratic optimization problem with one linear constraint. One of the ways, traditional ways to solve it, to reduce the problem to this unconstant problem, so the constant problem to unconstant one, by using a penalty coefficient p. The problem is that nobody knows how to choose this p. So people choose different values of p. For example, take p equal to 20, then we write optimality condition, this is a linear system, we solve it, and we obtain this result of the problem with p equal to 20. So that it is not clear how to obtain the solution of the initial problem for this. So people again use p equal to 40, 50, and so on, many, many runs in order to understand where converges this sequence of results. Renato De Leone has proposed to use gross 1 divided 2 and to use the infinity computer. Then what happened when he solved this linear system? He obtained this solution, and when divide these numbers, this is the final solution. You can see that again, there is a separability. 1/4 and 3/4 are the exact results of the original problem. So again, on the traditional computer, we should execute many runs and we obtain approximate results. On the infinity computer, just one run and we obtain the exact result. I have more examples also with the, for example, ordinary differential equations. I will go directly to show you what will happen here. Suppose that we have this equation and we would like to find the second derivative in the point zero. Since we know the exact solution of this, we can calculate it offline, and the exact result is -0.32. How can we obtain this result numerically on the infinity computer? Look, we use this kind of differences. So we evaluate y1, y2, then we evaluate this value, and again, when we obtain the result, you can see that there is a separability. There is an infinitesimal part, and this finite part gives us the exact solution. If we compare this technique with the very widely used Runge-Kutta 4 method, you can see that we have a huge improvement. Runge-Kutta method needs to execute 20 evaluations of the objective function to obtain f, to obtain this result. This is the accuracy. We, on the infinity computer, obtain better accuracy in significantly less number of evaluations. And if we would like to execute 100 evaluations by Runge-Kutta method, again, we have significantly less evaluations. So the infinity computer gives the improvement. And it is possible to develop completely new kinds of algorithms, improving, for example, here going backward and forward, better and better, the solution. I would like to stress that traditional computers have intrinsic problems with the accuracy that infinity computer does not have. Look, here there are the results of the solution of the solving differential equations for different values of delta in that formula approximating derivatives. So you see that when we use the traditional computer, then this is violet for 10 power minus 5 accuracy. Then minus 7, the accuracy becomes better. Minus 9, it becomes better. But when it becomes, the accuracy becomes minus 11, you can see that there is no improvement. And when it becomes minus 13, the results on the traditional computers with the accuracy minus 13 are much worse than the accuracy minus 5. So you can know, you cannot go and to improve your accuracy due to the physical constructions of the traditional computers. On the infinity computer, you can see this blue line, it goes, it improves and improves and improves without any problem. It becomes very easy to work with fractals. So this is the famous fractals, fractals of cancer, and these results have attracted the interest of MIT Technology Review. Here I will show you a little bit more fun example. Suppose that we have a process, fractal process, working like this. First you see the blue square. On the next iteration it becomes four red triangles. Then each triangle becomes two blue squares. So the process goes like this. So this is not a fractal, because a traditional fractal, because this is a mixture of two fractals of this kind. And traditionally, we are not able to say what will be in the end and infinity of the process, blue or red triangles or squares and how many. With the infinity computer, we can do this. Just say how many iterations you will do, and the infinity computer will compute what will be in the infinity, at that concrete point of infinity, blue or red squares or triangles and how many there are. So I conclude, I would like to say that there exists a popular book, Arithmetic of Infinity, and a lot of materials, including the links to the book on this site. And there are also videos of my lectures that are more longer than this one. This is the book available in Amazon, this popular book. And I conclude by with opinions of some experts in computations published in the international scientific journals. As you can see, they are published by one editor-in-chief, president of Operations and Research Society of Italy, other editor-in-chief, and so on. So thank you very much for your kind attention. I am ready for questions, if any.
Thanks very much, Mr. Sergeyev, for your interesting presentation on Infinity Computer. And indeed, if participants have any further questions they would like to ask our expert today, please feel free to type them in the chat box. We'll give at least a couple of minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva, and thank you, Professor. And I actually have the first question as usual. I don't want to wait too much time before asking something to the speaker. So, and actually, I would also like to maybe clarify something for the attendees. As you could see, if you attended some of the previous webinars today, we were very, very technical in terms of content, but this is it was done on purpose in the sense that there will be basically a new series, a new interest for the webinars in not just listening to professionals or experts that come from the world of consulting, as it most of the times it happened so far. But we will also have, from now on, and this is a clear example, inventors, so really originators of new ideas, concepts, technologies that might become innovations one day. So I think that this example fits perfectly with this intention. And hopefully, even though the math behind and in the slides of Professor Sergeyev was pretty tough, especially to me, but the point is that what we wanted to make clear, and hopefully what we will be able to make clear also by posting the video online and disseminating the video, is that this could be potentially a breakthrough. And of course there is a need for additional interest, especially from industry. So I think that this presentation was a perfect mix of technical details that, of course, professionals that are working in this field will appreciate, but also at the same time, for lay people like myself, it's an interesting first touch and first contact with a new theory that can potentially change and improve many existing products. So, more than finally the question that I have for the for our guest. There are any specific industries or any industry that you think might be potentially be more affected, positively affected, hopefully, than others? Or you think that the technology can be kind of tangential, so horizontal, and therefore influence many industries at the same time and in the same proportion?
Sorry, but I haven't seen the question precisely.
Okay, good. I can repeat it super quickly. So I was wondering if you foresee any specific industry as potentially affected by the adoption of the Infinity Computer, or if there will be a much wider spectrum of industries that will be touched at the same with the same intensity.
You know that nowadays the world of computations needs more computational power and more accuracy, because the models become more and more complex, and in many occasions the traditional computers are just not able to solve certain operations. What I have shown that the Infinity Computer will change completely, I tried to show obviously, will change completely our way of doing mathematics and computations, and in all the parts of the life where mathematics is involved, there will be this huge change, starting from the school, universities, going then to engineering, computations, to simulating, to models. Every year we have the new way of computing. I would like to make an analogy. So as I already told, Romans were not able to represent zero and to calculate 3 minus 5 and or 10 minus 12. So for them, all the computations with negative numbers and zero were prohibited. And due to this fact, they were not able to even to construct the computers. And you know what is the enormous impact of computers on our life. Because to construct computers, you need zero and positional numeral systems. So the way we do computation strongly bound our possibilities to evolve and to compute and to improve our life. And I expect the same huge change that has been done by passing from Roman numerals to positional numeral system as we will pass from positional numeral system to the new way of doing the infinity.
The analogy was pretty clear. So I understand what you mean, and I, of course, I wish you and the project the best of luck for the very next future.
Thank you.
Yeah, Eva, it seems that today the attendees are a little bit shy.
Yes, exactly. I can see the same thing. Yeah. So perhaps we can close today's webinar. And if participants have any further questions, they can always send an email to me, and I'll pass it on to Mr. Sergeyev or to you, Luca.
All right.
Would that be okay?
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I obviously am ready to answer by email or by phone any question and inquiry.
Perfect. Thanks very much, Mr. Sergeyev, for your presentation. And Luca, as always, thank you for co-hosting today's webinar.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thanks to you,
to the to Professor Sergeyev, and of course to the people that had the patience and time to be with us for this hour. And we'll see you for the next webinar, number 11th in March. Bye bye.